At Brixton Market, they're used to the Salvation Army, but not this way. No tambourines, no trombones. The Joystrings in their hit parade number, it's an open secret.
We had a new general, and he had a press conference. And they said, what are you going to do about your work with young people? And he uttered the fatal words, if we need to, we will take up electric guitars and go into coffee bars. And that was it. The BBC came on to us at the training college where I was then on the staff. And I was called into the principal's office. And he said, Captain Webb, tonight you will take a group of girl cadets and guitars and appear on the Tonight programme.
Joy then asked all the other officers, and the officer who was in charge of the men, at that time was Captain John Larson, he said, I have two cadets who have got guitars. I've seen them, but we couldn't play them. But that's how we were chosen.
And that's literally how it started. The viewers just absolutely jammed the switchboard and said, we like this, they're clean, we can understand what they're singing. They smile, we like it.
I need someone beside me to help me on the way.
I never ever saw myself doing this public work to the extent that the Joystrings thrust me into. It was never my intention. It's not me by nature.
It just so happened that one of the bigwigs at the EMI recording company of that time was watching. And he rang Robert Dockrell, who was in charge of all Salvation Army recordings at EMI, and said, what are we doing with this little lot? Have we got them in the studio yet? That's a good story, really, because, of course, we didn't have any music. It's all right going on to television with a T-chess bass and a few guitars and stringing a few choruses together, but it's very un-all right to go into a technical studio with a T-chess bass. You need to get a string bass, you need to get some music, and you need to get a drummer.
And you can sing it.
Writing. I mean, it was just sheer necessity. The first song I wrote was this Open Secret song.
It's an open secret.
So we went and recorded it, Abbey Road. Beatles come out and we go in. We didn't know it was going to be released. About 6 weeks later, someone said to us, do you know you're in the hit parade? And we didn't.
I mean, we were just besieged after that. We went all over the place to play, of course. And you know, the interviews, it's very hard on you, actually, when you don't know how to cope with that kind of thing.
Love that's in my heart, so real, so wonderful.
The reaction of the public was phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. 6,000-7,000 people over the road here at St Paul's Cathedral, closing off the road and the police coming down because we played on the steps of St Paul's. And then you've got secular activities of people who ring up, like the Blue Angel nightclub in Mayfair rang up, could we go there? And so as young students, 2 o'clock in the morning, we were playing at the Blue Angel nightclub. We wondered what on earth was happening.
Days are flying fast and there is no time.
We went on about 1:30 in the morning, and there was this barrage of photographers. I mean, I was absolutely blinded. I couldn't see anyone at all as we sang the opening number. But all we did was to play our set and beam at the people. That's all we knew how to do. But we very soon learned that there were other serious needs in the place. I mean, I remember one night sitting talking to a girl who was in a typical 1960s kind of, you know, frothy dress, and she just poured the whole bit out to me. Drugs, a lot. And I had to become a good listener. And I wept with her, she wept, and I wept. I think at that moment I understood for the first time what all this was going to mean. You know, I mean, events had overtaken us, but suddenly I realised what function we're going to have to be in the middle of all this. And that was a very salutary moment, actually.
At Bunny Girl headquarters, the Playboy Club, the accent was on beat music to pull in the power. The Joystrings, the Army's hit pop group, were in full session, making it a swinging occasion for the customers.
It wasn't easy for us, I have to say, but we did feel it was a ministry to be done.
We got to know those girls. Some of them were young married girls doing it for money for their children, you know. They were normal, ordinary, nice girls. And we had lots of fun with them and lots of really serious talks about why we were doing what we were doing. There was a lot of respect between us.
Keep me in your love all the way.
It was fulfilling the mission exactly of the vision of General Coutts, of Fred Coutts, when he said, we must go to the people and speak in their language.
It was communication media of the day, if you like.
Hundreds and hundreds of people made decisions for Christ. You can't knock that, can you? You can knock the music. You can knock anything else. But you cannot knock people coming and moving towards a point where you can try to introduce them to Christ. That's what it was about. Thank God that's what it was about.
I trust you for friendship when I'm with you.